yet he chose to walk that road out of his love for you and me. Down the Via Dolorosa, all the way to Calvary. Por la Via Dolorosa, triste via Jerusalem, los soldados le brin paso a Jesús. Mas la gente se acercaba para ver a que llevaba aquella cruz. Por la vía dolorosa, que es la vía el dolor, como ven, vino Cristo, Rey Señor, y fue él quien quiso ir por su amor, por por mí. Por la vía dolorosa al caballo ya morí. The blood that will cleanse the souls of all men made its way to the heart of Jerusalem. Down the Via Dolorosa, called the way of suffering, like a lamb came the Messiah, Christ the King. Yet he chose to walk that road out of his love for you and me. Down the Via Dolorosa, all the way to Calvary.
Good morning, church.
Am I on?
Yeah.
Okay, so before I begin, is there feedback? Before I begin, just a reminder about something. When you hear a congregation say amen, what they're really doing normally is they're agreeing with what the speaker from the front is saying. They say amen in agreement. Okay, so let's see if you all agree with this. This church is blessed to have its youth.
Amen.
Okay, good. So you listened to the first part of what I said. So we're blessed to have our youth. You see the talent that they have. You see the dedication that they have. You see the children that came up for the children's story. This church is strong with its youth. Now, we are also blessed to have Tiana, Tanisha, Miss Jillian, and all of our Sabbath school teachers. So you forgot what I said at the beginning, or you don't agree with it. So let me say it again, okay? Okay, because maybe you don't agree. Let's see. We are blessed to have the youth, the people that are dedicated to the youth at this church. Okay, now. Let me say this. No one else should volunteer, just the people I mentioned. Okay, good, because you shouldn't be saying amen to that, okay? Miss Jillian came up, I think it was last week or something, and I just wanted to remind you something, okay? you can volunteer your time to youth, okay? You can, because this church needs it, okay? You can't rely on just a few people to do everything, okay? So, please, if you can spare 5 minutes of your time, okay, to talk to Miss Tanisha, Miss Tiana, Miss Jill, if you can talk to them and say, hey, I can do something, okay, I can spend some time to dedicate, because I'll tell you what, I've seen churches that have no youth, okay? I'm not going to talk negative, I'm just going to say, we're blessed to have youth, okay? So, let's act like it, okay? Okay, so that was just another announcement. Okay, we're doing the Art of Gospel, and this is actually the last one. I was blessed to be able to do the first one, and you got to see my masterpiece if you were here, which you won't be seeing today. It's a picture of a pig. However, the pastor did the middle two, and now we get the last one. Let me share a quote with you, okay? If this century is remembered for anything, it will perhaps be for the speed with which we embrace things and then let them go. Now, do you agree? Yeah, I would agree. We seem to embrace things, but then get over them pretty quickly. So let me ask you a couple things before I have a prayer. What is important in your life? What in your life do you embrace? What in your life do you embrace? If you would bow your heads. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you for bringing us here this morning. We thank you for what was done almost 2,000 years ago, where you sacrificed yourself on the cross for us. Lord, we praise you and give you all the glory for that. And we come before you today on our knees before you, praising you and thanking you for all things. In your holy name, amen. Death brings perspective. Death brings perspective. We live life in the fast lane. One day, you're in high school. The next, you're married. And then the next, you have two daughters, ages 6 and 11. And then the next time I blink my eyes, I'm going to have grandchildren. And God forbid that thought at the moment. But you know what I'm saying. You know exactly what I'm saying. We live life in the fast lane. But there is one thing that can bring your life to a screeching halt. There's one thing that makes you go from that fast lane all the way over, stopped on the side of the road. And that is death. Especially an unexpected death. Right now, there are six families mourning the six men that died in Baltimore this week. These men had the ground removed right from under them. Miss Alethea, her neighbor, is dealing with something that all of us wish we'd never have to deal with. Life is not as usual for those families. It's not as usual. All of you here, anyone that's dealt with a death, knows exactly what that means and what that feels like. So why does death do this? Why does it have this power? Why does death of a loved one stop living in its tracks? Maybe it's because death forces us to embrace life. And death makes us realize that we are in dire need of the one and only one that can deliver us from it. You see, the disciples, they were not expecting what was about to happen. They were not. Now, had they been told what was going to happen? Yeah, they had been told. They had been told, right? Just like sometimes we are told that death is going to happen. They were told it was going to happen, but they were not expecting it. They had put their heads so deep in the sand, like ostriches, they were not ready. Like us, they were living in the fast lane. But perspective was right around the corner. So let's see if we can gain some perspective by focusing on two of Jesus' disciples during this horrible time in their life. So let's start with John. What do we know about John? What do we know about John? First, and you may learn something, you may already know it, but first, John was the youngest disciple. John was the youngest disciple. In Conflict and Courage, we read, the Savior loved all the 12, but John's was the most receptive spirit. He was younger than the others, and with more of the child's confiding trust, he opened his heart to Jesus. Thus, he came more into sympathy with Christ, and through him, the Savior's deepest spiritual teaching was communicated to the people. And you can kind of see that if you read John. You can see that when you read John. Now, even though he was the youngest, John was the only disciple brave enough to be there at the crucifixion. Right? That's what the Bible tells us. The rest of the disciples, where were they? Gone. Scattered. John was an eyewitness to the crucifixion, and he tells us that. And it's funny how sometimes John talks in the third person. In John 21:24, it says, this is the disciple, referring to himself, who is bearing witness about these things and who has written these things, and we know that his testimony is true. He saw it happen. He was a witness to it. The other disciples cannot say that. They were not there. Now, according to history, he was the only one who did not die a martyr's death. All of the disciples suffered and died, but John suffered and endured. Therefore, he is the disciple that lived the longest. Now, keep in mind, he was tortured. He did suffer. This isn't some, I'm not saying that all the other disciples had a horrible life, they died, and John was living it up. No. Ellen White tells us in Acts, it says, Acts of Apostles, John was cast into a cauldron of boiling oil. But the Lord preserved the life of his faithful servant, even as he preserved the three Hebrews in the fiery furnace. He was thrown into a cauldron of burning oil. I can't imagine. I've been burned with oil on my finger, and that was horrible. I mean, like, the pain that felt, right? Now imagine that all over your body. I mean, it's crazy. Obviously, you wouldn't be able to live but for Christ and the miracle that he performed. So John did suffer, but through Christ, he endured. Now, later in his life, John was banished to the island of Patmos. And while there, Jesus spoke to him and inspired him to write the book of Revelation, which is a book about the resurrected Christ. Revelation 1:18 says, I am the living one. This is John writing Christ's words. I was dead, and now look, I am alive forever and ever, and I hold the keys of death and Hades. John wrote the revelation of Jesus Christ. It's not just revelation, it's the revelation of Jesus Christ. Another quote from Ellen White says, though banished from the scenes of his former labor, he did not cease to bear witness to the truth. Even in Patmos, he made friends and converts. He was a message of joy proclaiming a risen Savior who on high was interceding for his people until he should return to take them to himself. And it was after John had grown old in the service of his Lord that he received more communications from heaven than he had received during all the former years of his life. Isn't that amazing? He lived a long life, and he was blessed to have Christ communicating with him to the end, to the end. And we also know that John was close to Jesus. He was close to him. John and his brother James were nicknamed what? The Sons of Thunder. The Sons of Thunder. They were brash and they were haughty, right? But Jesus had a significant effect on John. John went from being a son of thunder to a man of relationship and a man of love. John embraced love. You just read the book. You'll see. He embraced love. John saw that love was a reflection of Christ's character, and he wanted to have that character in him. We must understand, at the time of the crucifixion, think about this, at the time of the crucifixion, John probably did not have the same understanding and character that he did when he wrote the book of John. However, we do know that at the time of the crucifixion, John's transition to a man of love had already begun. And he had a very close relationship with Jesus. I want you to firmly put that in your mind, that John, at the time of the crucifixion, had a close relationship with Jesus. He was close to him. He was a friend. Now let's move on to one more of the disciples. Let's talk about Peter, okay? Let's talk about Peter. What do we know about Peter? Well, Peter was one of the oldest disciples. John was the youngest, and Peter was one of the oldest, if not the oldest, okay? He was also the first disciple called by Jesus. He was the first, okay? It is inferred that he was the oldest, since he is the only disciple first that was married, okay? He was the only disciple that was married. And then Scripture gives us more evidence. Oh, did I go forward? I didn't mean to. Scripture gives us more evidence than this in Matthew 17, 24 through 27, where the collectors are asking Jesus and his followers to pay the temple tax, okay? So they're saying, hey, you need to pay the temple tax. Now, Jesus asked Peter to do something funny, okay? He asked him, why don't you go catch a fish? All right, go catch a fish. Catch a fish. They're asking for a tax. They say, go catch a fish, but so that we may not cause offense, go to the lake and throw out your line, take the first fish you catch, first one, open its mouth, and you will find a 4-drachma coin. Take it and give it to them for what? For my tax and your tax. For my tax and your tax. Okay? Now, Jesus says that the coins are to pay both Jesus and Peter's tax. Now, those that were under 20 years of age, they did not have to pay a tax. It was only for those 20 and older. Okay? And the verse before this, Jesus actually clarifies and says, then the children are exempt. The children are exempt from the tax, okay? So Jesus said to him, in other words, the other disciples are children in that the government does not consider them adults, 20 and more, for them to pay the temple tax. So we have a good understanding that Peter was probably the oldest of the disciples. Now the Gospels of Matthew, Mark, and Luke have Peter as the first disciple called by Jesus. Now it seems at first glance that the Gospel of John has Andrew, okay, Peter's brother, as the first disciple. But John is actually telling the story of how they all met Jesus for the first time, okay, not actually how they were called by him. Therefore, when Jesus called Peter to be his disciple, Peter had already met him before. When Jesus lists his disciples who become apostles while praying, he lists them in the order that he called them in Luke. Okay? He lists them in the order that he called them. One of those days, Jesus went to a mountainside to pray and spent the night praying to God. When morning came, he called his disciples to him and chose 12 of them, whom he also designated as apostles. And here he's going to list them in the order that he called them. Simon, whom he named Peter, his brother Andrew, James, John, Philip, Bartholomew, Matthew, Thomas, James, son of Alphaeus, Simon, who was called the Zealot, Judas, son of James, and Judas Iscariot, who became a traitor. We all know that those that wrote the Bible love to throw that little part in there about Judas being a traitor. Now, while John was by Jesus' side when he was being crucified, okay, so we know Peter's one of the oldest, okay, he was first called. John is by Jesus' side at the cross, at the crucifixion. Was Peter there? No, Peter wasn't there. Where was Peter? Well, let's rewind. Jesus is in the Garden of Gethsemane, and the soldiers came to take Jesus. Now, Peter initially seemed to be brave, okay? He grabbed a sword and cut the ear off of a priest's servant. Now, you know, I say seemed to be brave because here are all these soldiers that come. And then you have some priests, and then you have the servants of the priests. Peter didn't take out a sword and go at one of the soldiers and say, no, you're not taking my king. He went to a servant, okay, and he's like, well, who's the one I can take? You know, who's, I don't know how brave, I mean, it was brave, okay? He pulled out a sword and cut off an ear, right? But again, it was the servant, right? So he initially seemed brave, but he didn't stay that brave, right? After the realization that this was going to happen, that Jesus was going to be taken and there was going to be some heavy punishment laid down, and Peter and the other disciples realized, hold on, this could include punishment for us too. They scatter. Now, he doesn't scatter before he, of course, denies his Savior three times. Denies him, just flat out. We all know the story. He denies him. But later on in his life, Peter ultimately chose to be crucified upside down by the Roman authorities rather than be crucified as his Savior was crucified. I mean, imagine that. Imagine how brave Peter was in the end, right? Where he was like, you're going to kill me? Don't crucify me upside down. Which I can't imagine what kind of death that would be for somebody. John 21, 18 through 19 says, very truly I tell you, when you were younger, you dressed yourself and went where you wanted. But when you are old, you will stretch out your hands and someone else will dress you and lead you where you do not want to go. Jesus said this to indicate the kind of death by which Peter would glorify God. Then he said to him, follow me. And then Ellen White says, Peter, as a Jew and a foreigner, was condemned to be scourged and crucified. In prospect of this fearful death, the apostle remembered his great sin in denying Jesus in the hour of trial, and his only thought was that he was unworthy of so great an honor as to die in the same manner as did his master. He took it to the end. How he felt upon denying his Savior, he took it to the end. He felt so unworthy even to the end. Peter had sincerely repented of that sin and had been forgiven by Christ, as is shown by the high commission given him to feed the sheep and lambs of the flock. But he could never forgive himself. Not even the thought of the agonies of the last terrible scene could lessen the bitterness of his sorrow and repentance. As a last favor, he entreated his executioners that he might be nailed to the cross with his head downward. The request was granted, and in this manner died the great apostle Peter. And in this manner died the great apostle Peter. So we have John and we have Peter, both living in the fast lane. John with that relationship with Christ, and then Peter at the time of the crucifixion, having denied his Savior and turning away and getting out of there. Then you have the death and the crucifixion of Christ, and everything changes. Everything changes. The resurrection is a defining moment for John and Peter. The idea that Jesus is alive gave hope to both of them for different reasons. For John, he is going to see his close friend again. He can't wait. He is so excited. For Peter, he's able to be restored. He's able to get some kind of redemption from what happened, from his denial of his Christ. They're in two different mind frames when they hear that Jesus is not in the tomb. John 20, verse 3 through 8 says, so Peter and the other disciple, again, it is funny how John talks in the third person. He refers to himself a lot, and here he is referring to himself. Just keep in mind, he is talking about himself. So Peter and the other disciple started for the tomb. That's him. Peter and John started for the tomb. Both were running, but the other disciple outran Peter and reached the tomb first. So this is John saying, hey, guess what? I'm faster than Peter. Okay? I outran him. He bent over and looked in at the strips of linen lying there, but did not go in. Then Simon Peter came along behind him and went straight into the tomb. He saw the strips of linen lying there, as well as the cloth that had been wrapped around Jesus' head. The cloth was still lying in its place, separate from the linen. Finally, the other disciple, who had reached the tomb first, also went inside. He saw and believed. He saw and believed. No matter where their mind frame was at the time when Mary Magdalene came and told them before they took off running, no matter where they were, when they heard of the resurrection, when they heard the gospel, they ran toward Jesus. They ran as fast as they could toward Jesus. The resurrection transformed these men. They became men that embraced life through Jesus. The resurrection gave them boldness to preach the resurrected Christ. Acts 4:13 says, now when they saw the boldness of Peter and John and perceived that they were uneducated and untrained men, they marveled and they realized that they had been with Jesus. These men were transformed into these bold men that could preach a resurrected Christ. So I haven't shown you the picture yet, so let's go to the picture. This is called The Art of the Gospel. Here we've got the picture. Now, I forget the name of the author, and I don't have it written here, but if you want to know the author, after service, I'll tell you. But here's the picture, okay, that we have. And I'm going to share with you a little bit excerpt. Last time I shared a really long excerpt, but this is a little excerpt from an interpretation written regarding this painting. Now, first I invite you to take out your postcard that you have. If you have a bulletin, there should have been a postcard. So you've got the picture with you and you can keep it. Hopefully you've kept each week's picture and you can keep it with you. Okay. The painting visually captures Peter and John running to the tomb. I hope you got that already. On Resurrection Day. Let's take a moment again to reflect on this. Now you may say, hold on. I thought you said Peter was older, but not that much, you know, like older than 20, right? That guy looks pretty old, right? Okay, fine. I don't know what the painter was thinking, but it is what it is, okay? This is Peter. That's John. You do see the younger on this side. Let me read from the interpretation. That is what is happening to Peter and John as they race toward the empty tomb on that first Easter morning. They are losing their interest in the mere emptiness of the tomb, which Mary Magdalene had so tragically proclaimed, and running with expectancy to find a risen Christ, who is indeed the Son of the living God. The eagerness of that expectancy is accentuated in every line of their face and their body. They are running to their Christ. John running to see his friend that he so loves so much. And Peter needing that redemption. Peter wanting to see Christ to say, I am so sorry. I need forgiveness for what I did to you just days ago. We get caught up in our lives and we lose track of what is important. You may be sitting here and realize that you have turned away from Jesus, that you are not living a life that you know would please your Lord and Savior. Or you may be, maybe you haven't turned away from Jesus, but you have lost your hope. You've lost your hope. The truth is that it doesn't matter where you are at in your life right now. It doesn't matter where you are. It doesn't matter if you denied your Savior 3 times 2 days ago. It doesn't matter. Because Jesus Christ is risen from the dead. And because Jesus Christ is risen from the dead, what are you going to do about it? What are you going to do about it? It is a fact. It happened. It happened. What are you going to do? Are you going to do as John and Peter did? Are you going to run to him? Are you going to run to Jesus Christ and let him change you? Are you going to allow him to make you bold as these two men became? So that you no longer worry about sharing the gospel with those around you? We have a choice this morning and in our lives. We can continue to live in the fast lane that we're in right now. We can continue to live that life where we don't have time to open the Bible. We don't have time to get on our knees. We're living the fast lane. We're living the life in the fast lane. Or we can embrace the resurrected Christ, and we can embrace the life that his death has given to us. Please bow your heads. Dear Heavenly Father, we come before you again thankful for the gift that you've given to each one of us. Lord, you have died for us, and you have risen from the dead for us. You are our risen Savior. You are there to provide all things to us. Please reach every single one of us. Touch our hearts and our minds so that we know to be true that you are there, a resurrected Christ, to change our life, to turn us from a people that are too devoted to what is important to us into a people that are devoted into what is important to you. Please go with us from this place, dedicated to you, and a people that are yearning and longing to embrace you. In your holy name, amen. I believe we have a closing song.
Closing song, In Christ Alone.
Amen. The benediction for this Sabbath is from Psalms 121. The theme of the psalm is, "Guard the help of those who seek him. I will lift up my eyes to the hills. From whence comes my help? My help comes from the Lord who made the heaven and earth. He will not allow your foot to be moved. He who keeps you will not slumber. Behold, he who keeps Israel shall neither slumber nor sleep. The Lord is your keeper. The Lord is your shade at your right hand. The sun shall not strike you by day, nor the moon by night. The Lord shall preserve you from all evil. He shall preserve your soul. The Lord shall preserve your going out and your coming in from this time forth and even forevermore." Amen. You may be seated. The deaconesses will dismiss you from the front pew. Please do stay for fellowship lunch if you are able to. Hope you all have a wonderful Sabbath. Thank you.
Dismiss us.